प्रयोजन उद्देश्य नमी प्रवर्त इन द कॉमन रैपिड स्टेज विच इज विदाउट हैविंग अ पर्पस द मोस्ट इडियटिक एक्टिविटी इन द वर्ल्ड इज एट एंड ऑफ द नाइट सो ईच एंड एवरीबॉडी जीसस आफ्टर एन अपॉर्चुनिटी फॉर अटेनिंग अ पर्पस इन डीपर गो व्हाट एवर दे हैव अचीव्ड दे हैव क्लियरली अंडरस्टूड दैट देयर आर टूल्स फॉर सम अदर पर्पस व्हिच इज साइलेंटली डांसिंग इन द इंटरनेट The salubrity and the satisfaction of the mind by circumstantial amicability, the apparential richness and status of the society, dignity, and whatever they see, they have understood that these are the tools. Whereas the means of our survival is something which is different from that. After deep thought and self-subjection, analytical pursuit, realization, literary consignity, and the grant of universal wisdom, they understood that the ultimate purpose of everything is shanti or peace in different degrees. And whatever we do, whatever we say, whatever we acquire, everything is for the installation of peace. Identification of the peace, after identifying the entity of peace, maintenance of it, and whenever it is debilitated and diluted, restoration, reinstallation of the same. This is very clearly understood by people of different groups. This shanti in various degrees, for example, if it is momentary, that momentary thing what we call is pleasure, and momentary mental fit we call by satisfaction, and by self-centric satisfaction we call it as complacence, and the spiritual solace we call it as tranquility. And as a global holistic entity or philosophy or phenomenon, it is known as peace. Peace is all encompassed, comprehensive, eternal, distributed. This is what we call shanti in Sanskrit, in the highest order of the hierarchy of satisfaction. And micro peace is what we call mental satisfaction, and macro, inexhaustible satisfaction, that is all around, is known as peace. Shanti, 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 that which is contributing, that which is distributing, and that which is eternal and inexhaustible, it is a quality of peace. And, you know, peace is very much understood when we lose it and we miss and pray for it. And whenever we grow not only with the craving for peace, but also with the hostile element and the magnification. So, the remedial measures are also becoming magnified. And more meditative processes must be hereby cogitated and properly implemented by proper guidelines. So that's why we have taken this topic of nuclear policies and peace initiatives. Because any tool is of contextual nature. To talk about nuclear energy and peace initiative is just like discussing about the comfortable rest of sleeping inside the locked cage of a ferocious hungry tiger. So it is such a massive energy resulting in colossal destruction with such a surrounding. Discussing for peace is a real challenge before the mankind. Because anybody with power, just as it has been clearly told by Paul Ehrlich, the famous ecologist, giving cheap and abundant power to the society is just like handing over a machine gun to an idiotic child. So in such an era, it is known as a nuclear era, each and every age, stone age, copper age, there are different types of ages as per the historical survey, anthropological survey, ethnological survey. Likewise, there is a nuclear era. And each and every country, you know that everything runs by power. Knowledge is forced to education, and education aims at science, and science is practically felt in technology, and all the technical equipments and the systems run in power. So the whole necessity of the world is in energy. The requirement is energy, the demand is energy, the source that vivifies the whole technocratic society of the globe is energy, the crisis is automatically will be the energy factor. So the more demand and energy has made the people to deal with the exploration of new energy sources. And these energy sources are salubrious. Some sources are pernicious, some sources are ambivalent. It is like a bi-edged weapon. The policy of the developed, a civilized nation must be energy independence and self-reliance. It must have provisions for the energy resources and the enrichment and reprocessing facilities with mechanical precision and perfection. That must be naturally the greatest of any nation. Whenever they seek the opportunities to get into energy probe, it is known as a dual use technology. Modern science is a dual use technology where it is used as an energy reactor material as well as a military material for war and aggressive fight. So it is bi-edged weapon. So this is the nuclear era, and how to manipulate the nuclear energy and what is the standard policy of India is to be discussed on the basis of the Vedic proven custom. Insight of the Vedic literature must also be incorporated within this 45 minutes of this specific time. Peace, generally we want to define with five statements. Number one, peace is nothing but an ever-existing orderliness. Nobody can create peace. Nobody can create peace in the world because it is ever-existing. What we have to do is we have to extirpate the hindering factors of peace. Peace is God-given and it is eternal. There are a lot of factors which are coming across. These obstacles have to be removed. Number one. Number two, peace is impossible to be dreamt even, to be distributed to all, because peace is the right of the noble and innocent. It cannot be distributed to the evil-minded, because it is the right of the noble and innocent, and they deserve to get peace. And it is the bounded duty of the elite and empowered members of the society to contribute peace to their dependents, those who are innocent, pious and virtuous. Number three, just as peace is eternal, all the obstacles to peace is also eternal, and the struggle is also eternal. One should tirelessly thrive and struggle hard for establishing peace. So it is a lifetime achievement and it is a cosmic time achievement which consumes precious times and step missions. Because these things are all eternal. Nitya Dharma is to say. So one must eternally, peace is all encompassed. So one area or another area, there will be always a depreciation, a diversification, aberration. These things must be properly governed, tuned and channelized by a group of committed, radiant, vibrant, effulgent, brilliant personalities who are divine incarnates or divine deities. Number three. Number four, peace is an ornamental attribute of an active, productive and prosperous society. Peace or silence or inertia in graveyard or in cases of sluggardishness or irresponsibility. You can see a lot of people sitting peacefully without doing any work. That is sluggardishness, irresponsibility, perfunctory nature, prevaricated nature, perverted nature. Whatever we see here in stages of silence and inertia without contributing anything to the self and the connected society, that is not a peace. That is a short time rest or complacence which will result in the total annihilation and turmoil of the social system in long term. So peace is the quality of, peace is the driving force of, peace is the fuel of an active, productive and prosperous society. And moreover, peace is the language of wise, and we cannot communicate with the language to the fools who cannot comprehend it. So peace manifests in different types, and we have to erect and install this peace depending upon the person, the opponent's mental setup, his intellectual capability of inhibition and retention, his spiritual caliber and oratic status. All of these things are taken to be considered, and then we have to realize the communication system which will be fruitful and infallible. These are the general explanations of peace before getting into your question. And installation of peace is by five major methods. One, peace by defense, because the whole globe is consistent of different varieties of people. I have already told you, loko bhinna vichitra. There will be civilized society, there will be self-centric society, there will be geocentric, cosmocentric, altrocentric, anthropocentric society, and there will be brutal society, there will be blind, cannibalistic society, and in spite of the civilizations, what we call now civilization is not by ascent towards science and technology and richness, appearance or attire. Civilization is the culmination of a person's mental perfection in which he thinks about mutual benefit or ready to sacrifice himself for the benefit of people at large. This is not a civilization, this is a mark of civilization. And that type of civilization which is just peripherally seen, it is nothing but Shavalankara, decoration of a corpse. So in that civilized society, there are different types of people, apparently civilized, but clandestinely very brutal, blind, and who are ready to create a global annihilation and an anthropocentric colossal loss. The total turmoil of the existence of mankind itself. That's what we used to say. Mankind must be led by a kind man. He only can lead the society. The potential man with a lot of kindness, compassion, altruism, cosmopolitan benevolence to the whole society. So in this society we have to take different types of soul. Just as a mother feeds the infant, grown child, sick child and various other child's physical, mental acceptance and repulsions are considered by the mother before feeding. Likewise, we also take different tools depending upon the availability of resources and financial status. Be governed by agents of patriotism and prudence. Second is defense by war. There are some situations in which it is known as Shanti Yuddha or just war in English. Philosophy, that is the war ethics, also justifies. Wherever the loss of mass, the loss of valor, glamour and color of the status of your nation, wherever you have to lose the pride of your national glory and status, wherever you have to lose the chastity of your national status, wherever the only option left is cowardice, there war becomes the rule and principle, it becomes the nyaya. So wherever the person takes a second strike, who is not initiating a war, but whenever a war is waged on the subjects, whenever it results in the loss of various dependent subjects, unnecessarily as a collateral damage, in order for prevention of these things, you must have a second strike. That is what Krishna advised just war in Bhagavad Gita. That is establishing peace by war. Whenever there is a calamity that can be controlled but only by war, we must not be reluctant to utilize it. We can think about minimizing the opportunities of getting into war, but till we get a civilized atmosphere, you see, if you are having lot of thoughts on peace inside your mind, if we are establishing World Peace Institute, if we are conducting Vishwashanti rituals, we may not expect the Arab people to behave like that or to say like that. In a controversial society where a lot of people are yet to learn about the values of beneficial benevolence and total cosmopolitanism of seeing a broader society with universal brotherhood and appeal, till we get that, we must be very clear in our defense and war mechanics. Third is to create the same peace by social justice, law and order inside the society. What is social justice? The society consists of the first man. The first man is a person who is in power, who is in dignity, who is in plutocratic status, and whatever may be the other richness of the society, he is the first man. The last man in the society is a common man. So a country or a situation where the first man is capable of getting the retributive justice and the last man getting the contributive justice, that is not social justice. Justice is of two types. Justice is not only punishing people. Giving punishment to that of the malicious persons is known as retributive justice. Giving rewards to society, to the common man, is known as contributive justice. Contributive justice must go to the bottommost person, and even the topmost person must be punished. He must be given the retributive justice. That is not a real social justice. That is maintained by law and order. And the fourth tool is education and ethics. Education and ethics, they have the shariratma sambandha. And now, like Sita isolated from Rama, kept under the mighty control of Ravana and Ashokavana, which is really Ashokavana, education has been isolated from ethics and kept inside the institutions, which are just sharing information, books which are just a burden to human pride and totally non-applicable to the surroundings for any productive change or information. So education and ethics are inseparable. In older ages, you know that there were classes for moral instruction, there were classes for self-realization. See, what is patriotism? What is the defense status of the country? What is the war status of the country? What is the famous history of our country of great personalities, sages, scholars and scientists? How to create sages and scientists? You see, a really prudential person will not be just talking about the past. What is the gap between the sages? What is the hierarchy? For example, if there is a hierarchy, parampara, we used to call it dynasty, then it immediately brings the next person. Okay, some Galileo was there, how about Galileo? Then where is the parampara? How many sages are there? How many scientists are there? We can talk about Chandrasekhar, C.V. Raman, Rabindranath Tagore, they were Nobel laureates, they got awards, they were physicians, and they were great poets. We can name a very, very, very limited, Anguli Meya, very limited people, just where is the hierarchy? So, to create a society, just as it is agriculture, what we call where seeds are put and more things are produced, it is known as ontoculture. Getting the inspiration from departed people and initiation from the available people. There are two people, Vigraha Dasha and Vibhava Dasha. Those who are God, they can impress you by inspiration, by the transcendental vibrations. Those who are other, they can initiate you. So by getting these radiations of inspiration and initiation with the departed and available souls, transcendental personalities, robust personalities of impregnable spiritual status, we can glorify ourselves to create an uninterrupted disciplinary traditional succession of scholars and scientists who are the pillars of the modern society, going to be the pillars of the postmodern society. So education and ethics, it has 20% of peacemaking. 20% peacemaking by defense, 20% by war, 20% by social law and order, 20% by education and ethics, 20% by spiritual means, which is the vital of all other modes, by prarthana. In each and every ritual, we used to say shanti, shanti, shanti. In our personal rituals, even the personal rituals, you see, there is a depletion in solar fluid. Wherever, you know, whatever that is subjected to creation will be subjected to destruction. And whatever that is created and destructed, it will have a diminishing standards. These things are inevitable in rules of nature. Likewise, there is a depletion in solar fluid because it is also created by God. It may be some long-living bias. When compared to us, it may be long-living. But certainly it is also ephemeral when considered about the global age, about the cosmic age. Suns, there are thousands of suns. There are 12 crores of Aditya. There is solar depletion. In the Sandhyavandana Bhashya, the arghya that is offered, the holy water that is offered, it is destroying thousands of mandehas, which is nothing but the energy disturbing agents of the solar fluid. So each and every day, whatever we offer, the holy water in Sandhyavandana, is Gayatri Japa meditation, is nothing but it is compensating the depletion of solar fuel as well as energizing the solar agency for totally integrating the society with rich knowledge and potential vibration for activity and activation. So each and every even personal activity, personal action or ritual or anything that is governed by the Vedic principles, directly or indirectly, intensively or peripherally, knowingly or unknowingly, it is connected with the wholesome welfare and all-round well-being of the society. So spiritual well-being, that also governs the peace initiatives to be productive and everlasting. And science and technology is nothing but, it is a blossom stage of education. Well-blossomed education results in science. And science implemented is known as technology. This must assist these people. So these are the five major tools for peacemaking. And unless all of these things are unanimously made in their respective proportion, we cannot create real peace. Second thing is, what are the tools that determine the peace and their standards? One is the socio-economical factors. Second is the ability and stability of the political standards. That is very important. Ability and stability of political standards. And the third thing is natural disasters. And fourth thing is, the sensational discriminatory factors are the barriers of religion, on the barriers of languages and on the barriers of ethnicity. So these are the factors that we used to see that they are disturbing peace. See, peace is not disturbed by a single agent. So we have to create a customized methodology for peace initiative. What is the country? What is the population? What is the education level? What is the acceptance level of the people? What is the political stability? What is the economic level? What is the employment resources? Taking into account all of these political, economical, cultural, moral, social, and various other backgrounds, we have to frame such a customized network for creating peace. There are no doubt common features for peace which can be accepted by any person. That which has common acceptability, universal adaptability, and eternal relevance. This thing is Parama Dharma. It is also there, but more than studying the hasty generalization policies and techniques, there are some customized situations. For example, teaching of Dharma, the principles of way of life, the art of smart living and systemized way of living as enunciated in our scriptures. Teaching the same to a person here is different from teaching the same in a tribal country. That a person's civilization, where the person's acclimatization of the universal standards of accreditation is very low, that initiation is very difficult, is a threat to a person's life and vision. So customized way must be immediately designed as per the design of the mental, physical, socio-economical status of an individual, institution, society and nation. It has also seven major dimensions. One is individual. The individual has four expositions. One is a personal, as a member of his domestic status, as a member of his academic status, as a member of his professional status. Four. Then these various things reflect in the society, society reflects in the nation, and nations reflect in the global peace. There must be a proper methodology for arriving at global peace. It starts with an individual peace. And individuals are also not of a single kind. If an individual is a potential person, for example, if a person is disturbed in mind, there are persons who sleep or take rest. There are some persons who are very brutal and blind. For such persons, if there is peacelessness, restlessness, that will indulge it to go in aggressive methodologies. There are five major dimensions of the society. One is Neta, one who has the leadership quality. There are two elements we used to say in Sanskrit. One is Vyapaka, second is Vyapya, the permeator and permeable. For example, there must be a person who can permeate and control 10,000 people. Nayaka, Atinayaka, Vinayaka, Mahanayaka, Jagannayaka. There are different types of people who can lead thousands of people. For example, if I am treated by the society as an individual, as a spiritual person, I may take it as an universal rule or a cosmic principle and I can justify it as an inevitable or ineffable or unintelligible principle of divine destiny. Then I can keep quiet. But if the same fellow is of an aberrant position, totally deviated from moral spheres, having also aggressiveness, we used to say, give a mad person a stone, he will drive you far. Give him the throne, he will make you war. Depending upon the power that is associated with the person's madness, the intensity of its impact on the society and its laws, consequential measures will be more. So if the same person of a retaliative nature is treated by the society, and if he is also having the charismatic personality of alluring people, either by finance, or by his oration, or by his administration, or by his so-called valor and other principles which are having peripheral alluration, such a person will form a gang, and this will take roots, deep roots into the society, creating untold miseries and menace to the existence of innocent. So Neta becomes a leader. The quality attracts thousands of people with various other qualities out there. There are a lot of qualities to attract modern people who are having a weaker mental setting. So they can be easily attracted. So this type of Neta, they attract the second grade of people known as Tarakas. Tarakas are a group of people doing same thing as a bounded loyalty to a single person, those who are having a group commitment of activity, whether it may be beneficial or beneficial. The second group is Tarakas. Third person, the Sahayakas, the funding or resourceful persons. They may be either coercive extraction of wealth or voluntary distribution of wealth by international agencies or internal agencies or intra-territorial agencies. There are different agencies there. So these people, Sahayakas, Then these people, they used to brainwash the society and create a group of sevakas. These sevakas, as per the financial resources executed and implemented by sahayakas, which are in turn reflected by the activities of tarakas leading by the neta, they affect the samuha or the society, either giving benefit to the society or victimizing the society. This is the hierarchy of both being a malified or bona fide society. If the person selected, the problem is there are a lot of netas in the other side, malified side, in bona fide side, to create such a hierarchy, impeccable hierarchy, with uninterrupted traditional discipline succession, with this neta, taraka, sahayaka, sevaka, and samuha is very difficult. It needs the group of various levels of people. So political stability and socio-economical factors, they distinguish natural disasters, as well as the various things like ethnic, linguistic, and religious barriers, they also create a lot of sensation and create a lot of problems. These things are all based on political stability. That is what peace cycle of interdependence. It is known as peace cycle of interdependence. Political stability can only give social empowerment and economical empowerment. And political stability can be made possible only by a group of committed, vigilant members of the society, supraja. We used to always say that a sleeping citizen is 1,000 times dangerous to the nation than a sworn enemy across the nation. So this vigilant citizens, the group of committed people, they must elect and establish, because now it is a prajatantra rajya. It is a democratic country which has democracy for democracy. In this country, the people have the power to throne, enthrone, dethrone and rethrone the people without any rational background. So, to educate the society, to become a good citizenship, entrepreneurship is there, hospital management, then self-management, self-governance, government administration, business administration, entomology, epistemology, metaphysics, cosmology, archaeology, new divisions are there. Robotics, artificial intelligence, genomics, genome mapping, DNA database, lot of scientific things are there. So unless you create a society with a stable and powerful government, you should say a government must have three qualities. One is independent government. Independent government. Second is potent government. And third is a vibrant government. Independent government does not depend upon anybody for doing good, we used to say. Then if it is purely independent without any moral, then it is nowhere different from tyranny. So it must be potent also to withhold all suppositions and oppositions within the nation. If it can control internationally, then that becomes a vibrant government. We used to say in Sanskrit, Tatra Svatantro Raja. Svatantra Svatantra Chakravarti. Sarvatantra Svatantra Sarvabhauma Samrat. So those who can govern themselves, they are known as Raja. They have independence. And those who have potent, that is those who have the potential standard, they can control any force in the nation. They must not be self-dependent. Self-dependent, a person is dependent on his own desires or personally motivated interpretations which cross against the welfare of the nation. Person being very much captivated by the family background or relatives or by any other allied parties or opponents or society. So it is totally independent, potent and vibrant. Such a government can be formed only by vigilant citizens. Vigilant citizens are formed by education centers. Education centers need not be such a close auditorium hall, it will not be there. All education centers at the time of the freedom struggle that were done in the course of drama, in the course of public speeches, in the course of pamphlets, you know that Hitler, without having proper money to print his sayings, his words, he just wrote in several papers and he used to distribute it door to door delivery. Such a great dictator, he designed and drafted the writings and he distributed himself in a bicycle. So like that, education is any source of knowledge, either through speech or by a syllabus or by any methodology of making the people to approaches or making the unknowing people to realize it by ourselves approach. So these things are the education. So education's validation is in ethics. And ethics is submitted to the intellectual members of the society who are in association with their patronage, proper patronage. So it is known as the peace cycle of interdependence. peace comes from an area of socio-economical prosperity and self-sustainability, which comes from political sustainability or stability and unity. Political ability comes from the collection of a very capable, patriotic, loyal, dedicated members of the society who are nothing but the outproducts of proper way of education or channelization, which must be backed by the ethical phenomena, and the ethicists are none but the intellectual patriotic members of the society with proper patronage and approach. So it is the interdependent cycle by which we have to arrive at the peace. Especially now, this is the peace initiative on various backgrounds and groups. Now taking this into context, now destruction,